Hello, I'm Greg, and it's time for another Tunnel Take. Yeah. My pipe motto is, go big or go home.
Yeah. Hello, y'all. This is Greg, and you're watching another Tunnel Take. Enjoy the video.
Yeah, I love them. This is Greg. This is another Tunnel Take. Hey guys, you know, I came up with that little idea of people doing little intros, you know, for a goal of mine that I had, I guess it was almost, I guess 6 months ago. Don't think I own that idea or anything. If you guys want to do that sort of thing, it's kind of cool to be able to look back on them and that sort of thing, you know, and repost them sometimes, stuff like that. If you don't want me to repost that video of you doing that intro for my channel, let me know and I'll take it out of the rotation. It's not really a rotation I'm doing. It's just one of the things I'll do from time to time. Stick you on there at the beginning. Anyway, this is mainly a VR to Big Smoke Phil across the pond there. He wanted to know about the jobs that we worked, the funniest moment of a job that you were, that sort of thing. You know, he's having his, I think it's 400 subscriber giveaway is what he's having. And let's see now, I've been self-employed almost all my life. There was a few times that I weren't. I guess when I was 12, I started mowing with a push mower in a cemetery that was right next to our house. And it's probably about, a 5-6 acre place, I guess. I don't know if it's that big. Yeah, it's probably that big, yeah. And, maybe bigger than that. Old established cemetery. And, then I stayed in that line of work till I was like 40. Now, about when I was, when I was about 15, there was a teacher at our high school, and he had a pig farm. I don't know if you guys ever worked in a hog house. Oh boy, I tell you what, I worked there for 2 days and came home, you know, smelling like absolute crap. I'm telling you, you know, you're washing these stalls out where the pig crap's everywhere, you know, you're doing a water hose and all. Well, kind of a higher pressure hose than a water hose, but anyway, my mom said, nope, you ain't gonna have that job anymore. She won't have that odor around her, I'm telling you what. I think when I was about probably 21 or something, a friend of mine pulled stints on a tugboat. He was the engineer, and he knew I had a lot to do with motors and stuff like that. I rebuilt my first motor when I was 16. And rebuilt right mini motors, V8s, small block V8s is what I was mainly into. And and he knew I wanted to try the tugboat job, you know. So he was going to propose to his girlfriend that Christmas, and he was going to skip out on pulling the shift that 2 week or so period between Christmas and New Year's. That was when he needed to work. And I said, well, I'll pull it for you, Christmas and New Year's. So and I think I was on there for about 17 days. I think we went up to Baltimore, just running the canal systems through down the East Coast, the Intercoastal Waterway. Baltimore down to Jacksonville, Florida, waiting for big loads of paper in 6 and 7 foot round rolls and stuff like that. To be, you know, we would haul them to a factory to be processed into notebook paper, maybe, or whatever, toilet paper, who knows what it was going to be. That was probably the most miserable day, where we had to sit beside this pulp mill where paper's actually made. And boy, the stink coming out of that place. Woo! We've got a pulp mill about, I don't know, probably 100 miles from here, maybe not even that, probably 60 miles. And to go through that town, whoo, man, I tell you what, the odor's strong in places. Waiting on pipe to be put into the barges. You know, we were mainly pushing barges. When we went across the the mouth of the Chesapeake Bay, you know, the ocean is able to flow in there, so we had to pull the barges then, because there were such waves that if you were pushing the barges, and they were cabled to the barges were cabled to the tugboat, there were such waves that they would break the cables, so we had to get to have this 7-inch round rope that was tied onto the barges, and we'd pull them behind us, that type of thing. And yeah, that was kind of an experience for sure, you know. Of course, I didn't do much, because I wasn't familiar with everything. It was just like I was just there. The main engineer, when he was asleep, I was pulling the shift, the midnight shift, I think is what it was, or maybe it was a 12-hour shift. And and I was kind of there just to, if something went terribly wrong in the engine room, I would run to the bedroom and wake him up and say, get out of here quick, that sort of thing, you know, and keeping eyes on gauges and stuff like that. It was a easy job for me, you know, really, you know, but because I was just there to keep an eye on things and holler for him if something went wrong, you know, because I was so unfamiliar. I was kind of like out of my element as far as mechanics goes, because I'd never dealt with any two engines that are 10 foot tall, 12 foot long, I guess they were, maybe 20 feet long. They were huge things, you know. And the engines that were just over there as generators for the ship were bigger than engines I'd ever worked on, you know. But I understood the concepts of what was going on, basically, you know. So that was kind of interesting. I just didn't want to be away from home that much. You know, I'm just more of a family man than I am that type of work. So, and that was, like I say, that was in the winter. So during the lawn mowing, I had a lot of time off, you know, in the winters when seasonal work is over with, there's not much going on. So you kind of got to scrape through life, you know, build up enough savings from the summer work to get you through the winter type stuff. Anyway, so, kept mowing lawns, went into it with both feet by the time I was probably 20. I think I was about 21, 22, because, after I decided I wasn't going to do a tugboat thing, that's when I decided, I'm gonna hit this lawn mowing stuff real hard. And that's what I did all the way till I was 40, I guess, and ended up with three 455 John Deere's. That's about, you could get a 54-inch cut or a 60-inch cut, and they were three-cylinder Yamaha diesels. Now, the Yamaha diesels were just awesome diesel motors, for sure. I mean, a Yamaha diesel is just incredible. Ended up with that and a 1600 John Deere lawnmower, which was maybe I can find a picture. I'll put it in the corner down here or something. It has wings on it that goes out and cuts about 11 and a half feet. and it folds up, and you can just use the front deck, and I could lay some yards out with that thing, y'all. Me and my son, just me and him together, the most yards we did in a day was 44. We did 44 lawns in a day. Now, these lawns were probably about a half acre, because we're in that very rural area, there was there's not very many small yards, you know. And all them yards that I'm talking about were mainly hunting club yards. Where I come from, I came from Hyde County in North Carolina. That's and it has Lake Manamuskee in the center of it, kind of. And it was just a bastion for hunting, waterfowl hunting. And way back 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s even, a lot of the old timers bought small houses and old farmhouses or whatever, you know, and would come down in the wintertime and stay in the house just to use it as a hunting camp type house, you know. But they wanted the lawn mowed. They didn't necessarily want it looking good. So what I could do, I could take weed killer, Roundup weed killer, and spray around the house and spray around the trees so there was no trimming to do. You didn't have to get a lawn trimmer off the trailer. And it was just a ride. And once the wings fell out, oh my gosh, I could just wear them things out, them places. We just leave the truck running with air conditioner on. I mean, it wasn't even worth cutting the truck off, because I could do them so quick. When I bought that, I was like, of course, I knew that the way to get out of labor cost was to buy bigger equipment. Now, farmers in these areas do that sort of thing. They'll have these, discs 40 feet widths and stuff like that, with these huge four-wheel drive tractors to be sure that they can pull the thing. And if you can get something like that, and you cut out so much labor cost of having these little teeny tractors and with these little discs all, you know, that sort of thing, you know. So it's just a business economic thing going on. And ended up with, all the Hyde County school system stuff, 100 yards, two lagoon systems for the sewage water treatment areas for two different towns in that area, a good size nursing home with a lagoon, with their own lagoon system in the back there, for wastewater. And that was and three cemeteries. And that was my life up to 40. And then I went to Denver to flip houses out in Denver. So did that for 2 years, and the bubble popped in 2008, 2009, something like that. And came back to North Carolina. Now I live here in Greenville, North Carolina, and I have a carpenter business, and my sons all helped me with that, and my daughter, and until they got old enough, we went to college and all got their degrees and all this good stuff. And now I'm just a one-man band. And I've become so efficient that, and so able to do things by myself. You know, installing 12-foot crown molding is still a challenge, but I can do it, you know, by myself, you know. One of the funniest things, Phil mentioned about the funniest thing that happened on a job or something. And I had a trimmer. Now we had like four backpack trimmers. There's Husqvarna, then the motor's on the back, which all you're handling then is a flexible shaft that comes from the back, and an aluminum shaft with a trimmer's on. And we could trim forever with them things on, you know. Because you're just not holding, you're not bent over, you're not holding a motor on your arms, you know, it's on your back. Real comfortable, you know. And we were mowing this yard. There was a grade line all the way around the yard. Of course, this is very low territory. 3 foot above sea level, probably the average for the whole county. And I come across this drain or something, fell foul on my face. All the guys, you know, they were laughing. I said, yeah, everybody loves it when the boss hit, you know, makes a face plant. had some good times lawn mowing. Hard physical labor, man, I've always kind of liked it, you know. Anyway. So, that's my work history. I was watching Piper Ken tonight. He was talking about his pipe acquisition disorder. He said, well, I got 31 pipes or 30 pipes, whatever it was, you know. I got one for every day of the month. And I don't think I want to buy any more and all that stuff. I said, yeah, I heard that one before. You can hang that up, Ken. It's going to raise its ugly head one day, and you'll have 3 more in the mail. It does get crazy, I'll tell you what. Nobody's asked, nobody's looked at my pipe cabinet and said, hey, Greg, how many hands do you have? How many pipes can you smoke at one time? Anyway. Yeah, I'm smoking an Arrowhead in my Brian Quilty gifted to me Canadian. It's a Savinelli. I forget the numbers of it. Anyway, 7.5 inches overall length. Love this little thing. Of course, you guys know that. And can't find anything like this long in this Sea Rock rustication. It's really nice feeling grippy rustication that keeps your hands kind of cool, you know. It's a great little pipe. Anyway, y'all guys have a good night. I'll see you. Bye now.